Okay, thank you. I hope the sound is okay. That should be spinning, but anyway, it doesn't really matter. I'll carry on. What I'm going to do is give you a brief overview of the NeoShield project. NeoShield is an FP7 project. It's funded by the European Commission to the tune of, in total, 5.8 million euros. We got 4 million from the EC, and the partners have contributed 1.8 million out of their own money. And we started off in January 2012. We're funded for 3.5 years, which means we're now well into the project. We've got another year to go, roughly. And at this point, I normally in past talks I've talked about what NeoShield is intending to do, but now, of course, after two and a half years, I've really got to start talking about results. I'll attempt to do that now. I'm also talking really on behalf of the 13 partners in NeoShield, so I'm going to be talking about work that other people have done as well. So anyway, let's remind ourselves what this is all about. We're talking about near-Earth object impact mitigation. Why do we need to worry about that? Oh, there you go. See? Well, yeah, you've seen this before. This is the fireball that exploded over Chelyabinsk, the super bolide, with an enormous velocity, and it exploded at an altitude of about 25 kilometers. 1,500 people had to go to hospital after this. This was, you know, the worst case we know of, I think, of any injuries as a result of basically an asteroid impacting the Earth. It's a lot of energy. Here we're talking about 30 times the amount of energy released in the Hiroshima atomic bomb. And we would expect something like this to happen around about every 100 years. And of course, there was a previous event, the Tunguska event in 1908, which was similar to this, we think, a somewhat smaller object. No, somewhat larger object than the Chelyabinsk object, and that flattened a forest of, I think, 80 million trees over 2,000 square kilometers. So these are things that don't happen very often, but when they do, they have the potential to cause great damage. On the very same day, the 15th of...
I can't hear you, so let me check. Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Oh, right. Okay. Shall I start again? No. On the 15th of February 2013, on that very same day, an event occurred that we were expecting. Chelyabinsk, we didn't expect. It came out of the daylight sky and surprised us. But this object here, 2012 DA14, we were expecting that one. It was discovered about a year before it made this incredible close approach to the Earth, passing through the geosynchronous satellite ring, so really coming through our back garden, basically. It has still a diameter of, I think it's slightly less, about 30 meters, actually. And it came by at an altitude of 28,000 kilometers. We would expect an impact of an object of that size every 1,000 years on average. And I think a close approach of an object of this size, we would expect about every 40 years. So just think about this. We have had last year on the same day an event which occurs once every 100 years on the same day as an event which occurs once every 40 years. An amazing coincidence. But as far as anybody knows, this is just a coincidence. And I think that the message you can take from this is that, you know, really very, very unlikely thing. Not only can very unlikely things happen, but they do. And we mustn't forget that, because the consequences of forgetting that could be extremely serious. There's one other point I'd like to make here, and that is that if DA14, which was a stony object, a silicate-rich stony object, if it had entered the atmosphere, the effects might have been similar to those of the Tunguska events in 1908, this destruction of this forest. Of course, over a built-up area now, a heavily populated area, the consequences of this sort of event would be really dramatic. If DA14 had entered the Earth's atmosphere and had been a metallic object, right, it could have formed a crater, such as the one in Arizona, formed by, we think, an object 30 to 50 meters, about the same, in the same size range. And this is a 1.2 kilometer diameter crater. Imagine that over somewhere, if that had occurred somewhere in Western Europe today. So we have to remember that it's not only the, we're interested in estimating, thinking about the damage that could be caused by these objects and about mitigating or deflecting these objects. But a very important point is also the mineralogy. What are they made of? How do they behave when they actually enter the Earth's atmosphere? What happens? And also, we also need to know the physical properties, to understand the physical properties of these objects better, in order to come up with good realistic deflection techniques. So I'll come back to this point about stony and metallic objects later on. So what do we need to do? The impact hazard. We're a little bit worried about, we shouldn't lose sleep over this, of course, but we experts should be concerned about what the consequences of these things could be and what we might do to prevent impacts of near-Earth objects. The first thing you've got to do is find them. And this is a part of the job now which is being done very well. We have a number of search programs set up, which mainly, if not, yeah, pretty well, mainly funded by the United States, but there are observers all over the world that are not as well funded, but still manage to do good work. And basically, I think we're still finding about three near-Earth objects every night. We're finding them still at about a rate of 1,000 per year. And we're still finding big ones, surprisingly. Supposedly, we found nearly all of the, if not all of the, practically all of the objects with diameters of larger than 1 kilometer. But we still come up occasionally with some big ones that haven't escaped detection until now. So we need to find them. Oops, that is something that is being done very well. And there are new telescopes being developed now, which will search for smaller objects to give us at least a week or a couple of weeks warning of a Chelyabinsk type object, as Detlef mentioned yesterday. We also want to understand their compositions and physical properties, and we're involved in this in NEOShield from the point of view of deflecting asteroids. If you want to talk about deflection techniques, we have various techniques such as the kinetic impactor. You've heard about this, where you just slam a heavy spacecraft into the asteroid to change its orbit, transfer momentum to it. The main goal of the NEOShield project is to develop detailed designs of mitigation test missions, demonstration missions, and we're concentrating on the kinetic impactor because that seems at the moment to be a very realistic option. But we're also looking at what we call blast deflection, which would be the sort of last ditch attempt to deflect a large asteroid or one that for which you have very little warning time, using presumably a nuclear device to give you the blast. And we're also looking at the gravity tractor, which is a slow pull. Yesterday, this is the kinetic impactor deflection concept that was investigated or studied under the auspices or funding of ESA some years ago now. And of course, it's important to also not only to investigate the physical properties of the entire population, if you like, of hazardous near-Earth objects, but also to actually go and visit some of them and do some close-up rendezvous in situ investigations of individual objects. You can get a lot of information, obviously, if you send a rendezvous mission up there, such as the Japanese have done with Hayabusa. There's a Hayabusa 2 mission now in preparation. We have, yes, we're running this from the stick, not my laptop. So I've got a not quite the latest version of this. I forgot that, I'm sorry. Not quite the latest version of my presentation. So I've still got Marco Polo on here instead of Osiris Rex. Marco Polo was a European mission which has, unfortunately is not going forward in the Cosmic Vision program, but we do have the American Osiris Rex mission, which is rendezvousing with a carbonaceous asteroid and will bring back material from it. So, and we have Rosetta, of course, which is the big European ESA mission now approaching the comet Churyumov-Gerasimenko. And that means these missions, however, are very, very expensive. And so, you know, to go and visit an asteroid, it's many hundreds of millions of euros, dollars, or whatever. And so you can't do many of those missions. But what we can do is also observe the population of objects in general using ground-based telescopes and indeed space-based telescopes. And in particular, I'll talk a little bit later on about WISE data that we've obtained from the American the NASA WISE mission, which have been very useful, and they've obtained data on I think over 100,000 asteroids in total, and several thousand of near Earth objects. So, moving on, this is the consortium, and we have here the 13 partner organizations that are members of NearShield. Remember that that Astrium, now called Airbus Defence and Space, is three different partners according to EC rules. We have to count the three different Astriums in these countries as different partners. So in total there are 13. And I've updated the names here. I think most of the people here are that are active, currently active on the project are mentioned, the sort of leading personnel, if you like, although not everybody that's doing useful work is mentioned here, I should hurry to point out. But anyway, this is what it looks like. And you can go to the website, which is really intended for the general public, I think, but there's useful information there. And we aim to add to that, especially now that we're getting some results in and publishing a few papers. These should be available from our website. The website is run by our partner Astrium in Germany. So, so what we're actually doing, I think I've already pretty well said it, is we have different aspects of the project. In no particular order of importance, but we are looking at physical properties. I think one of the important questions is, presumably one day, we're going to find an asteroid coming towards us, and we're going to decide we can't let that hit. We've got to do something about it. So there will be, somewhere up there, there's an object, which is the first one that is going to trigger a deflection, a spaceborne deflection attempt. Now, what is that object going to look like? How big will it be? What will its physical properties be? What will its mineralogy be? Its structure, porosity, density, and so on. And of course, we don't know the answers. But what we can do is to try and limit the range, the huge range of values that that object could have by investigating, by looking at the population of such objects in general. So that's the sort of the approach we're taking. As I said, one of the, if not the major goal, is to come up with detailed designs of deflection concepts or deflection demonstration missions. And if we're going to carry out, which we can't do on NearShield, we don't have the money to carry out a demonstration mission, unfortunately. But in order to do that, you need target asteroids as well. And so we had a talk yesterday from Siegfried Egel about the selection of target asteroids. If you want to We've got lots, obviously, of, it's very easy to go to potentially hazardous asteroids because they have orbits that bring them close to the Earth. They're very accessible, but if you start messing around with a potentially hazardous asteroid, you might turn it into a hazardous asteroid. We don't want to do that. And so there are aspects of this targeting which, when you get into details, it's quite a complex thing. And we've been looking for suitable targets. The other point is, of course, or another point, is that you have to worry about the size of the target. We would very much like to be able to deflect small objects, such as, you know, the Chelyabinsk, or not, well, not quite that small, then, but come down to about 50 meters in diameter. And at 50 meters, you really begin to maybe get a bit concerned that, depending on what the thing's made of, it could actually reach the Earth's surface. You've got a crater, huge amount of damage. And we would like to be able to mitigate against or deflect objects perhaps in this size range, 50 meters to 200 meters. Below 50 meters, it's likely that decision makers would say, well, you know, in most cases, something like that's just going to explode in the atmosphere. We might flatten the forest. We're probably not going to do a huge amount of damage. And when you get to, when you go up to the other end, to 200 meters and beyond, then you're faced with persuading taxpayers to cough up the money to develop a deflection technique for a potential impact that you might have once every 100,000 years or so. And that's, I think, that, you know, we have to limit this. The other point is, if you go very large to a kilometer and say, well, look, that could actually destroy civilization as we know it. But with a very large asteroid like that, we'd have decades of warning. And so it seems to me, you know, even if we started from scratch, we could probably do something about that, given the decades of warning. So I don't think we have to worry too much about the very big objects of, say, you know, several hundred meters and above, because we already know there's nothing up there, I think, that's very big that's going to come at us in the next 100 or couple of 100 years. So we are interested in this range. The problem, if you're talking about a kinetic impactor, you've got to hit the thing, and you've got to hit it at the right point on its surface and at the right angle. And if you're coming at it with a very large speed, typically, say, 15 kilometers a second or something, you've got to worry about the guidance system, which has to be autonomous to actually hit the thing in the right place. As we heard yesterday, I think Detlev's Siegfried's talk about the beta parameter, about ejector. You want to maximize the amount of ejector coming back at you so that you enhance the forward going momentum of the asteroid. And so if you actually hit it way off center, you hit it somewhere, if it's an elongated object and you hit it near the end, you're going to change its spin vector. And you're going to lose energy that would otherwise go into the ejector generation. So there are considerations like that that we're looking at. Our partners in industry, Astrium in particular, Deimos as well, in Madrid, are looking at aspects of guidance, navigation, and control, which would be very important, that we would love to be able to demonstrate on a mitigation demo mission. Another thing that we're not doing, we only have a limited amount of time and funding, we're not looking at alternative techniques, of which there are many. Laser ablation, ion beam shepherd, you name it, there's lots of things that you could look into, in particular for the smaller asteroids that at the moment we might have difficulties with. And so it's something we're not able to do, but for the future, and my talk is about going beyond NEOShield, I think that's a very important point. To look at alternative techniques apart from the three techniques that we're looking at here. And as I said, you know, theoretical work we're doing, I'm coming to some of that and the lab experiments, computer modeling, it's all well and good to do this sort of thing, it has to be done, but whenever you do an experiment, you always learn new things and unexpected things, no matter how well you think you know the theory. And so I'm really firmly committed to the viewpoint that we really need deflection demonstration missions, and we won't be confident we can do the job until we've actually deflected, changed the orbit of a harmless asteroid. Okay, now I'm moving on to some examples of scientific results. We have managed to publish a couple of papers already, and I'm just going to talk about some of the work that's been done for those papers. I should point out here that the schedule of the work plan on NearShield, is such that the scientific work came first. So we started off with the scientific work packages, and the actual the technical mission design work is now really coming up to speed at this time. So I can talk about work that's already been done. I can't talk about work that we still have to do over the next 12 months or so. So that's why I'm limited now to more to the scientific side of the project. We have, in order to determine how an asteroid would respond to a deflection attempt, let's say a kinetic impactor, but you can imagine a blast deflection as well. You want to know something about the material properties. You want to know how, for instance, by how much the material, the porous material in the asteroid would be compressed, how much energy would be lost in compression of a porous asteroid, for instance. And there's lots of other questions that have to be answered about the type of material, the properties of material, the structure of the asteroid that you want to deflect. And we've started to look into that with laboratory experiments. First of all, it's not only hypervelocity gas guns, but also other sorts of measurements that are done on things like Young's modulus, shear parameters, and stress and strain, and so on. And there are the people at the EMI, the Ernst Mach Institute in Freiburg here, have provided a lot of data on the sort of properties of materials that we think are similar, analogous to the materials you have on asteroids. I don't know, you know, you have to just guess at what we might be faced with. Things like quartzite, sandstone, limestone, aerated concrete. These are the sorts of materials that they've been working with. what you can do is on with a big horizontal gas gun. We have vertical gas guns. We have people, another partner, the Open University in the UK is also working on this, and they I think they're using a vertical device. Here we have a very powerful horizontal gas gun with which you can fire projectiles into these blocks of materials, which we see here, and you can look at the ejector. You look at the amount of ejector that's thrown out, you look at the angle or the angles at which it comes out, and you do very, very high speed filming here. You can frame for frame, you can see exactly what's going on. So, excuse me. So we get detailed characterization of asteroid, what we call asteroid surface analog materials. And the point of all this, I mean, we get some very useful information about the sort of beta parameter, values of beta parameter you can have here, but of course on a very small scale. It's in the lab. We're not dealing with real asteroids. To get to real asteroids, you have to do modeling and simulation work, but we use the input data, we use the data from these experiments as input into the modeling work and scale things up to real sort of asteroid sizes. And we then can do modeling and computer simulations. Again, with the goal is to determine the magnitude of the additional momentum, this momentum enhancement that comes about as a result of the ejector produced in the high velocity impact. This is all focused really on the kinetic impactor, which we think is probably the most realistic option we have with current technology. But the results are also valid and useful for considerations of blast deflection using an explosive device, which would be placed either detonated either above the surface, on the surface, or maybe just below the surface, depending on circumstances. And we're finding out that these are results of the simulations, and you can see the crater here that's formed. You have again a speed of about 15 kilometers per second, and you can see how the crater's formed. But you can also see what happens within the structure of the asteroid. The red parts here show the damaged areas that are sort of feel the effects of the impact, if you like, and you obviously fracture the body, at least near the surface. And we find that the porosity is a very important factor here, and the strength of the material and the impact velocity as well also are important in determining the beta parameter, the amount of ejector that you get back and the enhancement of the forward going momentum. So that's very briefly the work that has been on my other on my laptop. You would see here a publication which I think is in Icarus by Patrick Michel and Martin Yutzi, who have published this work recently. At least this is a sort of first paper. There's lots of further work that will be done on this and will be published eventually. Because my time is limited, I've got about half an hour left, is that right, or 20 minutes, I want to move on to something that I've been working on myself, so I'm confident now I can tell you in accurate terms what's going on. What we've been doing is, I mentioned the WISE mission, the Wide Field Infrared Survey Explorer. And this is, you might have heard of this, it's a NASA mission which has observed over, it did a survey of the whole sky for all different topics in astronomy, all different fields of research. But in particular, it also, for our purposes, looked at over 100,000 main belt asteroids. And it gave us, it basically measured infrared fluxes over the thermal part of the spectrum, thermally emitted radiation from these asteroids. So it was working from about 3.5 microns to, I think, to 20 microns, something like that. And the what it provided us with, among it first of all, using a simple model of the temperature distribution over an asteroid, it came up with values of diameter and albedo for the asteroids it measured. And that's very important. Obviously, you want to know the size distribution and the albedo. The reflectivity of the surface material basically is related to the mineralogy, can give you some clues as to the mineralogy of the object. And so, but in addition to that, it also gave us values of the eta parameter. I'll just quickly explain what eta is. Eta is related to the thermal inertia of the asteroid's surface. Thermal inertia is easy to understand. If you're in a desert, you have a very sandy surface, and during the day, with the sun high in the sky, it gets very hot. As you move over, as the day wears on and the sun goes down, it cools down very quickly because dust has a very large surface area. It radiates the heat away almost instantaneously, and the temperature drops rapidly. That's low thermal inertia. And on an asteroid, if you have a dusty surface with low thermal inertia, you have to imagine that this thing is spinning, and that temperature pattern remains stable. So what happens as you move around here from the hot day side onto the night side, it immediately cools down. So the blue is a sort of a very low minimum temperature that you get on the night side. And this is the case for zero thermal inertia, when the eta value would be 1. In the case of high thermal inertia, you can imagine in a city, in the summer it gets very hot, and at night time it cools down, but it doesn't cool down quite as much as it would if you're in the desert. Because what happens is you've got material like concrete with a fairly high thermal conductivity, the heat is absorbed into the surface, and there's a delay in the resulting thermal emission that comes out again. And what happens is, because the asteroid is spinning, the thermal emission then comes out on the other side. So on the night side, this is not quite as cold as that. You see, there's no blue here on the night side. But to conserve energy, that also means you've got to reduce the temperature on the day side. And we can measure, we can actually see, using the data from WISE, we can actually use it, by looking at this eta parameter, you can tell roughly whether you've got this sort of temperature distribution or this. So we can roughly see whether we've got a low thermal inertia or a high thermal inertia object. So the eta value comes in here. This is the equation for the subsolar temperature. It's just thermal equilibrium. And this is the model. The model is based on zero thermal inertia. And what we do is we vary the eta value, basically play around with the subsolar temperature, until we get the model to fit the observed flux distribution. And when it fits, we take that value of eta, the best fit value of eta. And this is why, and I say eta can vary between, it actually can go below 1 because the roughness of the surface actually gives you a beaming effect, which puts the eta value down, increases the temperature of the surface in effect above the thermal equilibrium value. That means eta can actually go below 1. And the high eta value means you've got high thermal inertia. So the thermal inertia is defined as thermal conductivity times density times specific heat, or we'll take the square root of all of that. And so thermal conductivity is a very important factor in thermal inertia. As I've mentioned, with high thermal inertia, you conduct heat down into the surface of the asteroid. So thermal conductivity is very important here. So what we did was to take all of the reliable WISE data, main belt data, well, all data, this is mainly main belt asteroids here, and we plotted the eta value against infrared albedo. The albedo, as I've said, is just the surface reflectivity, in this case in the infrared, and it's related to the mineralogy of the surface, the composition of the surface. And you can see here that we get three clusters of points. We get at low albedo, there's quite a large cluster, and at the relatively high albedo values here, we have a large cluster. And in the middle, there is a more diffuse cluster, but you can still see a bit of a cluster there. And what we actually did for various reasons, which I won't go into, but we were actually interested in the maximum value of eta in bins of 100. So we took bins of 100 points and just calculated the mean eta of the top 10% of those asteroids. So we were looking at the maximum eta values. And we came up with this result, which was a bit somewhat unexpected, because people have done similar things in the past and have found no correlation between the eta value and the type of asteroid, the mineralogy of the asteroid. And so I was quite, you know, surprised to find this, especially this large peak here, right in the middle here. So it seems that the eta values in this cluster are somewhat lower than the eta values in this cluster, but right in the middle you have this amazing peak. And of course, the first thing we did was to plot on this the taxonomic types of the asteroids we were dealing with, and you can see those here. And we have the carbonaceous, the low albedo, the dark asteroids. These are carbonaceous objects, C types if you like, and related. They're supposed to be porous, maybe a bit like comet nuclei. And here on the right-hand side we have the silicate-rich objects. These are the S-types and related types. And you can see in the middle, the blue bullets are M-types, and M stands for metal. And these objects here, at least some of them, I mean, there are some M-types which may not be metal. It's all a bit of a controversial subject at the moment. But certainly many of them, many M-types will likely contain large amounts of metal. And it's right here that we find this peak. So it looks as though these eta values, which were really just simply a modeling parameter that enabled you to fit your model to the observed distribution of the thermal flux from the asteroid, seems that these eta values might actually be quite important in that they can point us to asteroids which have a metallic composition. And this makes sense because, as I've mentioned, the thermal inertia is largely a result of the thermal conductivity. The specific heat and the density can vary as well, do vary, but they tend to go in opposite directions. In other words, the specific heat of metal is lower than that of rock, whereas the density is higher. But on the other hand, so they tend to cancel out, but the thermal conductivity can be a factor of 10 different, roughly, more or less. So it looks as though the eta value here is quite significant in giving us an indication of whether we've got a lot of metal in the asteroid or not. Incidentally, when we took out all of the known M-type and all of the objects that were likely to have some or a large degree of metal in them, we ended up with this curve. So you see all the blue points have gone. The peak is still there. And this indicates that there's a lot of metal still there waiting to be discovered. It's just that these asteroids, there are lots of asteroids there which have not yet been identified as being metallic, which again I think is because this now can tell us, you know, we can say, you know, go to any one of these points here in this middle region of the plot and you're likely to find a metallic composition. The problem with identifying metallic asteroids without having this help here, or this new relation, is that normally, you know, asteroid taxonomic types are based on optical reflection spectra. And so by definition, you have to have the optical reflection spectrum to identify the so-called taxonomic type. You know, taxonomy is where you actually determine particular characteristic parameters in the spectrum, and you put the asteroid, the spectrum, into a particular box and give it a letter, A, S, C, whatever. And the way this is done is to, as I said, take the reflection spectra and look for features, like S-types have characteristic dips in their spectra, absorption bands, and other asteroids like an A-type here has a very steep spectrum, which is relatively easy to identify. S-types are easy, V-types, all of these silicate-rich objects can easily be identified from their spectra. But when it comes to metal, you have a very flat, boring, featureless spectrum, which you can very easily mix up with that of an E-type asteroid, which is enstatite, or a P-type, which is a dark sort of asteroid type, probably mainly carbonaceous. And so this is the problem, and this is why I think a lot of M-types have been mischaracterized. You can see here that there are blue bullets here in the middle of the C-type cluster. And there are probably a number of taxonomic classifications here which are wrong. And this is why probably I think we only know something like 40 or so M-type asteroids in the main belt. Now, for me, the icing on the cake is still to come. And that is that I thought, well, if you've got metallic asteroids, shouldn't you get a higher radar reflectivity? Now, you can actually observe also main belt asteroids with radar. You basically transmit a signal and look at the echo, the reflection. Obviously, we know that metal reflects radar better than a lot of other materials. And so we took a look at that. And we simply went into the catalog here of these objects and asked ourselves, well, which of these have been observed by radar? And that's relatively easy to do. And when we plotted it out on the same scale, this is what we got. And I think you can see that the envelope of the radar data follows quite well the envelope here of these eta values. And in particular, the cluster in the middle matches very well with the peak that we have there. So I'm very confident that we are actually looking at metal. These the eta values here from the WISE data gives us a good indication of where we should go, which objects we should investigate further for high metal content. And why is that important? I think, incidentally, yes, you here I have put in the paper that was recently published in Astrophysical Journal Letters describing this work, and it's from NeoShield Deliverable 2.1. And this is important, as I've mentioned, because it might make the difference between a flattened forest and a great big hole in the ground. So if you have an asteroid coming at you, you really do want to know at least what it's made of. I mean, a lot of other things as well, but you know, it is important to know whether it is a stony or a metal-rich object. Not only that, but of course you've heard most likely about initiatives in the States, private companies that are setting up now to investigate the possibility of obtaining valuable metals, potentially useful metals for modern industry, which are rather scarce and very expensive at the moment, and you can get some of these metals, platinum group metals, for instance, from asteroids. They're on there on the surfaces of asteroids. And of course, if you want to do that, you want to know where the metal-rich asteroids are. So we think this is important also for that aspect. So anyway, moving on. I'll mention again the business of mitigation demonstration missions. This is an animation of a kinetic impactor here from the Don Quixote work that was done comes from ESA. And again, you know, you can do all the sort of theoretical modeling work that you want, but there's no substitute for proving we can move an asteroid by actually doing it. So it's like, I think at least ESA, Detlef, we want a mission to deflect an asteroid. I don't think I need to convince him. What we're doing, as I said, is provide a detailed design so we can actually give ESA a detailed design of the mission we should carry out. We would hope, of course, that NASA and Roscosmos and other countries might be interested in helping out here.
Yeah. In fact, that's probably the only way we're going to ever get it funded. And we're working closely with colleagues at ESA, Detlef, on the SSA program there, and members of the NEOSHIELD Consortium are involved in the Action Team 14, and the new groups set up, the IAWM and the Same Page groups. And so we're going to see how those groups can help us to achieve some of these aims. Moving on to the future, I think there's a lot more work to be done in terms of characterization. If we're talking about the first impactor to trigger a spaceborne deflection attempt, I think the size of it will be in this range somewhere. It might be as low as 75 meters. It depends when it happens. I mean, if it doesn't happen in a few hundred years yet, we'll probably have greater technological abilities, better techniques that we can use. And we might be able to go for smaller objects around about 50 meters or so. But I think if it was to happen in the near future, then we're probably looking at something of 75 to 100 meters, or maybe a bit more. And there are about 200,000 objects in this range, of which only a small fraction have so far been looked at and explored in any way. So the things we need to do is determine the size of albedos, mineralogy, shapes, densities, structures, all of this stuff. This is all important from the point of view of mitigation and deflection. An important point is the structure, rubble piles. And this is something that is really still a big unknown and gives us a big headache as to how to deal with the rubble pile. A rubble pile is simply an asteroid made out of lots of little components which have very little cohesion. And it comes about by, for instance, a collision, which might produce a load of fragments that then fall back together under their own gravity, or an asteroid becomes fractured in a collision. In any case, there's very little internal cohesion in these cases. And of course, hitting a rubble pile or blowing detonating an explosive device near it is probably going to have very different effects to doing this on a monolithic lump of rock or metal. So we need to look at that. And there's a lot more work to be done on how a rubble pile would respond to any sort of deflection attempt. Observations are it's very necessary to continue doing sort of ground-based observations and, if possible, get some more satellite telescopes up there. There are a couple of ideas being investigated at the moment for WISE-type infrared telescopes that would be very useful. And the thing with infrared telescopes is you get the size, you not only detect near-Earth objects, but you get immediate information on sizes, albedos, and as we've seen, potentially the amount of metal in them. We also need to look at if we're dealing with any sort of deflection technique, or any sort of deflection technique requires some activity close to an asteroid, whether it be a kinetic impactor or a gravity tractor. You have to know how to target asteroids, how to hit them, or in the case of a gravity tractor, for instance, how to maneuver very close to the surface. You also have to do this if you're doing a rendezvous mission for characterization purposes. You need to hover near the asteroid, move around it, and all of these things are very difficult. And we would need, especially in Europe, we need to develop, I think, more expertise in doing that sort of thing. Rosetta will of course help. That's coming up. Also for surface material sampling and collection, in situ analysis, sample returns to Earth, all these things that we only have, we don't have much experience in doing that as a global community. And I think more of that sort of work would be very useful, and we could contribute to that in Europe. This is the, going back to rubble piles, I just put this in because these results came out recently, these images from the Hubble Space Telescope. This thing, I think, Detlef, did you mention it? Was this what you mentioned yesterday? Was this originally thought to be a comet at the main belt? It's a different one, okay. But this is one that I think was originally, yes, it was originally identified as a comet, but it became clear when it was, after these observations were taken, that this is not cometary behavior at all, and it looks more like some object has just broken up here. And it is thought that this actually is the very first direct evidence we have that rubble piles do exist, and they can actually break up if the rotation rate exceeds a certain threshold. You can see that this is the Itokawa near Earth object from the Hayabusa 1 mission, and this actually looks pretty much like a rubble pile. I mean, this does not look like a collision of fragments. It looks as though we've got blocks, different blocks that are just hanging together here under the very weak force of the gravitational fields. And you've got some rubble and dust and stuff over the surface. So we think, we're pretty sure rubble piles do exist, and if a rubble pile actually gets spun up, and it can do that by virtue of the Yorp effect, I won't go into that, but it's basically the action of thermal photons and also reflective photons, which on a very irregular surface, and it's like a windmill effect, which can either spin it up or spin it down. And if it spins it up, obviously, and if you have an object here with very little cohesion, it can break up. And we think, we're not sure, but it looks as though that might be what has happened in this particular case. So, and of course, if you've got something, another point is, if you've got something that's spinning quite rapidly, it might be on the point of breaking up. And if you then hit it with a kinetic impactor, or you stick an explosive device near it, it's probably going to behave, it will behave totally differently to a slow rotating monolithic object. And of course, rotation itself is a big issue. If you've got a gravity tractor, you have to maneuver very close to a sort of large rotating potato shaped thing. All very complicated. I won't go into this. This is, Detlef mentioned this yesterday, the two groups that have been set up under the auspices of the United Nations. What we hope to be doing here is all of this sort of stuff in the same page group anyway. We think that the sort of topics, the things that we've looked at in NEOSHIELD are very similar to the mandate that the same page has to look at space mission response activities. That's really what NEOSHIELD is all about. So I think our experience from NEOSHIELD will, at least at the start of, for the start of the same page plan of action, we can probably provide some input there. And it's going to be very interesting to see how this all develops. It's I think an important point here that we have to keep these things going. And it's okay, you know, if we would have a Chelyabinsk every year, then the politicians and the decision makers would have this all the time, they'd be aware of this. But what's probably going to happen now is we'll have nothing for a long, long time. And you've got to sort of keep the interest going. You've got to, it's difficult to see how this will happen. I hope it will happen. But the problem that we have is all the recommendations, all this work has to be done with no cost to the United Nations. So all of the activities have to be funded by the member countries that have signed up to it. But I'm cautiously optimistic. At least we've got this set up. I think that's a great advance, and we have to make the best of it now. And finally, this is just a few bullets to summarize things. I think we're all clear on the fact that if we don't do anything, and that's our choice, you know, we don't have to do anything, but then the catastrophic impact is just a matter of time. It's going to happen. So we should be aware of that, and I think it's sensible to do something. It's a global problem. There's no particular, I keep being asked this, you know, aren't the equatorial regions more likely to take a hit than the polar regions? But it's not true. Every part of the Earth could be affected. But not every country, of course, can actually do useful work. There are countries which are just not, don't have the technological expertise and competence to do anything in space. So I think it's up to the spacefaring nations to take the lead, at least, in developing a mitigation strategy for the whole planet. And the obvious address is the United Nations that should take charge of this. And that is what is happening, so I think that's very good. And another point, especially, we have this problem a little bit in Europe. The European Commission and the European Space Agency don't always see eye to eye. And this could be not exactly conducive to a rapid development in a particular field. And so I think we need to encourage a better set-up strategy understanding in Europe at the moment between ESA and the political decision makers. I think that goes for everywhere else as well in the United States. I'm sure they have similar problems and issues, and I think we need to, for this particular topic, it's very important, probably more important than many other areas of science and technology, that the politicians and the scientists and engineers understand each other, because the decisions that have to be made when any hazardous object is coming at us, they are largely political. I mean, the politicians will have to say, right, we're going to commit probably billions of whatever currency to tackle this problem, and that will be a political decision. But of course, they have to be advised by the scientists and engineers that understand the technical details better, and so it's very, very important that works well. And that's it at that point. I'll finish. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the very interesting talk. So there's time for questions.
Yes. It's an S type. I think, or S or Q, it's silicates, silicate rich anyway. Yeah, that's been quite well studied. Therefore, we also know it's not actually 40, I didn't correct that. I think it's slightly smaller, about 30 meters in diameter. Okay.
I was wondering there are any compounding variables that affect the estimation of data or everything else basically.
Yeah, the it's basically this equation, it's all very simple. This is the what I call the bond albedo, which is the covers the entire amount of energy that is reflected off the object. In other words, 1 minus A gives you the energy absorbed at all wavelengths. The S is the solar energy. We know that very accurately, that is incident on the asteroid. That's emissivity. We take this to be about 0.9. It's all traditionally taken to be 0.9, and nobody seems to think there's any reason for changing that. I've often thought about this, but if it's 0.8, it really doesn't make difference here, actually, it turns out. And sigma is the Stefan-Boltzmann constant. It's a very simple model, but it turns out that with this, you plug it into this, of course, this gives you the distribution, the temperature distribution over the surface. And you can actually fit any thermal distribution, flux distribution of any asteroid very accurately with this thing. It doesn't mean to say that you get an accurate diameter, an accurate albedo out of it. That's a tricky one, because it depends on what happens here is, as you go to higher and higher phase angles, the model does not take account of radiation emitted on the night side, which is normally small, but if you go to high phase angles with a high thermal inertia, it can become significant. and that's when the model then tends to overestimate diameters and underestimate albedos. But from the point of view of this work here and the eta value, that's irrelevant. Yeah. Well, these, what I've done here, these are means of 10. Each point plotted here is the mean of 10 eta values. And those are the highest 10 values in bins of 100. The reason for doing this and not just taking the overall mean in bins of 100 is because there's one thing I haven't mentioned, and that is the rotation axis. Now, this only works if the rotation axis is well away from the solar direction. If it happens that the rotation axis is pointing to the sun, you get no information about thermal inertia from the thermal flux distribution. Imagine this rotating like that around an axis that points to the sun here. This surface will always be hot, and you don't know whether it's low thermal inertia or high thermal inertia. The temperature pattern here would be the same. So that is a point. And by taking the top 10% of the eta values, you're selecting the objects which would have their spin vectors in roughly the perpendicular direction to the solar direction. At the moment we were just interested in seeing how this what happened. We had no idea when I did this what was going to happen, and therefore. But this is a very significant peak. I mean, the error bars. I think you can see, judging from how the point to point variability here gives you a rough idea of the error bars. Although, having said that, I'm pretty sure this is a significant peak as well here. And I think this is also significant because we're going off here into very high albedo objects, and we know that the E-type objects have high albedos, and that's what I think we've got here mainly. And they have also a fairly high metal content. So I don't know, but we need to do a lot more work on this. This is only the very first sort of. I started doing this about last October, and. Quite happy that we've already managed to get a paper into Astrophysical Journal Letters. It's a very quick publication channel.
Any other questions? Do you have a question? Because the first day, so she has presented a model, a dynamical model of how bubble ties form. Mm-hmm. So one option was to have big boulders connected together by thin powder, right? Another option is probably to have some sort of gravel that is kept together again by this. Mm-hmm. So with this kind of metal asteroids, So what do you expect to have?
Big boulders, interesting whether we know that asteroids exist, at least in the main belt, that are virtually all just iron and nickel, and they're supposed to be the cause of differentiated asteroids that have broken up into collisions. Now, I mean, you'd think metal would behave differently to rock, in that you could fracture a rocky body if you hit it hard enough, but can you fracture a metallic body? Maybe you can, I don't know. But so whether metallic rubble bars exist or not, I don't think anybody knows. And whether you get, as you probably, I don't know whether you get as much dust. Whether impacting, producing a crater on a metal metallic surface produces dust in the way it would on a silicate stony type object, I don't know. But if it were to do that, and you had a metallic dusty surface over your asteroid, I guess you could also then reduce the thermal inertia. So you might have a metallic rich asteroid disguised as a low thermal inertia object. Then this method would not, this wouldn't work. But the reflection spectrum would still presumably give you a very boring flat indication that it was probably metallic. I mean, if you take the reflection spectrum together with the albedo range, as you can see, they're all in this middle albedo range, then you can get an idea as to whether it's light to be metallic or not. But, I mean, Dan Shears up there, who is the expert on van der Waals forces, dust providing some form of cohesion between the components of a rubble pile, might be able to add something to the discussion. I don't know. What do you think about metallic rubble piles? Have you ever thought about that? I mean, metallic asteroids, let's be clear about it, are rare. There aren't that many around. As you can see here, the relative number in this part of the albedo range is less than either here or here. However, having said that, the fact that we've only identified 40-odd, I think, so far, is due to the difficulty in identifying them from these very flat, boring, featureless spectra, which you can confuse with other types. So it could be that there's a lot more waiting to be detected, and it might, I mean, we know in the near-Earth asteroid population that there's about 3 or so that are thought to be metallic. There may be a lot more out there. I think this actually indicates that there are a lot more out there, and I think it's a topic that has probably been neglected to date because we think they're very rare, we don't have to look too much. You know, the Barringer crater is 50,000 years old. I don't know whether there have been any other impacts of metallic objects since then. But certainly, you know, the two, we know Tunguska, we're pretty sure Tunguska wasn't, or Chelyabinsk doesn't appear to be, DA14 wasn't. But who knows? I think it's something we, you know, the consequences would be so dramatic of a metallic object coming at us compared to a rocky body. But we need to be aware, we need to understand the probabilities of how many there are out there.
Okay, we have last question.
Yes. Well, for a start, it would affect the density here. So it would affect the thermal inertia, no matter what it was made of. If you have very porous surface, and you do have variable density, look at Itokawa. There are dusty regions, there are rocky areas. So that would vary over the surface. For a very simple model like this, you can't take it into account. I think on average, guess what you normally do is you. The thermal infrared observations take so long, or at least with the satellites likewise, you come back and you have several sightings, and those sightings would be at different rotational phases, and it tends to all sort of average out. So I don't think density variability over the surface would make much difference. However, if you're doing a very much more complex thermophysical modeling of an asteroid, you take into account the shape, you take the rotation, all of these things then are go into the model at the start. And then if you do, the thing is you don't know, but if you did know about density variations across the surface, you'd want to put that in as well. So in You could do if you had in situ observations of a particular object. I mean, this is all talking about observing with a telescope when you don't resolve the object. But if you had a rendezvous mission, for instance, and you had a thermal infrared camera, and you were looking at the temperature distribution in detail, if you could measure it around the object, you would then find variability that we have nothing to do with it. And that then certainly would trace thermal inertia differences and variability around the surfaces, and those could well depend on, as you can see here, to some extent, probably to a large extent, on the density structure around the surface.
Okay, thank you very much. So if there are questions.